Garnie?
Yes.
Hi, I wasn't sure anyone was in here. It's so quiet.
Oh, yes, we enjoy the quiet. It's from our geothermal technology. Geothermal is a way to heat and cool your house. You remove the AC unit, and so thus remove all the noise pollution.
Wow, you even addressed the noise pollution. How cool. Everyone, this is Garnie Nygren, the Chief Operating Officer of Serenbe, a community in Chattahoochee Hills, Georgia, that has successfully established sustainability as a way of life. Thanks for joining us, Garnie.
It's a pleasure to be here.
Yay. I've been investigating the risks and benefits of using renewable resources versus non-renewable resources, and I was just so pleased to learn all about the renewable energy initiatives that are happening right here in Georgia. How did the Serenbe community begin?
Serenbe started, as we know it today, in 1991. My family went on a weekend drive and stumbled upon the original 60 acres of Serenbe. We moved here full-time in 1994. And in 1999, my dad and I were on a run and came upon somebody who was clear-cutting 20 acres. And my dad realized that we were in the path of the sprawl of Metro Atlanta, and that the only way to truly save the land that we had fallen in love with was to come up with a development model that had preservation at the heart of it. So that planning took several years. Serenbe broke ground in 2004. The first person moved in 2005. And today we have approximately 1,000 people living here. Serenbe is now 1,400 acres. 70% of that 1,400 acres will be permanently protected green space. And we'll have 5 neighborhoods that are built on 30% of it in dense European walkable villages.
What was it about Chattahoochee Hills that made your family think it was the best place to build this sort of community?
We couldn't believe that this amount of land, Chattahoochee Hill Country is approximately 40,000 acres, existed this close to the airport and to Atlanta. And we could not imagine it being disturbed through traditional development models. Having spent 10 years on the land, you get to firsthand experience through walks that Georgia has an extremely biodiverse ecosystems and fertile land, and seeing all of this in traditional subdivisions and strip malls was something that we couldn't imagine. And we often hear today, either from the development community or other people who have looked at places to say, like, this has to be too hard, right, for other people to follow. What we find is that wherever you are, there's almost always a way to build and access resources sustainably. You just have to think in those terms and be open to it can be easier and generally more cost effective.
Especially when we can use renewable resources to help power our communities.
Exactly. When we were developing Serenbe, renewable resources were extremely important to us. We felt that if we focused on how to make renewable energy work in a neighborhood, then there would be less incentive for us to rely solely on non-renewable resources. Some of our homes at Serenbe are net zero, meaning they generate enough power on site to offset the home's total energy use, typically on a monthly or annual basis. Most homes at Serenbe have rooftop solar that provides a portion of their annual energy needs. Both the net zero and the rooftop solar homes are still connected to the power grid, however, which gives you a backup if your backup battery isn't holding enough. They utilize electricity at night and on cloudy days, some of which come from non-renewable resources. There are challenges of going to 100% solar. There's a difference between zero and 100, meaning if you can't get all the way to net zero, at least start, right? There is geothermal as a beginning, and then bringing PV in. PV stands for photovoltaic, or also solar panel. Often find that people get stuck in, it has to be all or nothing, and there are always starting points to get you further than you are today.
So why did you choose solar energy?
Well, the sun isn't going anywhere. So we chose solar because energy from the sun is an abundant source that will never run out. Some people coming in from other states will say, like, why solar? Because they're used to other resources such as wind. But in Georgia, wind doesn't make sense. So solar really is the go-to in creating energy for homes or businesses. And so while solar was the best option for us, there are a lot of different communities that use clean energy to generate power. What's most beneficial is it's renewable and doesn't emit the greenhouse gases that contribute to global warming.
Yeah, especially considering how much energy we use on a daily basis. So you've efficiently harnessed energy outside. What about inside the home?
Inside the home, we have various parts that make them energy efficient. Aside from using solar energy, we've also targeted the areas that use the most energy, starting with regulating the temperature in the house. In order to regulate the temperature, you think about things like in new construction, there's so many options of creating different zones, right? That you have different floors of your home and different areas heating and cooling based on when you're using it. We think about window location all the time so that your windows aren't creating that heating effect during the day where you have the indirect heat coming in. The efficiency of windows that you're using so that your home isn't losing heat and cool that you're having to make up for. While at the same time, windows are located in a place that you don't have to use as many lights during the day, that you have natural light coming in so that we're not consistently stuck to having every light in the house on at all times. In addition, insulation. So we're so fortunate, like the insulation technology, especially if you're bringing in spray foam, completely lowers your energy levels as the home is such a tighter envelope.
So what about homes or apartment buildings that don't have geothermal technology? How can the temperatures be regulated more efficiently?
Well, one way is by also using nature. Depending on where you live, you can take advantage of cooler or warmer seasons to open windows or shades to let in the sunshine. Aside from that, you can set your thermostat to 78 degrees Fahrenheit in the summer and 68 degrees in the winter. Every degree of extra heating or cooling will increase energy usage 6 to 8%. It's a misconception that setting your thermostat to a lower temperature than normal will cool your home faster. Instead, you can use ceiling or standing fans more often than the air conditioner. In the summer, you can set your ceiling fan's direction to counterclockwise, which will send cool air down to the floor. The high-speed air evaporates perspiration and creates a wind chill effect, so you feel cooler without actually affecting the room temperature. During and after a shower, you can use your bathroom fan to help remove the heat and humidity from the space. If you have the opportunity, you can also invest in more energy efficient air conditioning units and even windows that have increased insulation, like we were talking about earlier, to help regulate temperatures as well. In general, to conserve energy, you can always just make sure window and door cracks are sealed to keep cool or warm air inside your home. So many people don't realize like how much air is getting out of their house by just those little factors. And be sure to turn off all fans when you leave the room so that you're not using that energy when you're not there. You can also visit energy.gov for resources that individuals and families can use when making purchases or ideas for energy consumption and efficiency. There are so many phenomenal resources and experts out there.
These solutions are so much more doable than I even anticipated. So what other parts of this home are energy efficient?
Another area of the home that uses a lot of energy is the water heater. That is used to heat the water that we use to shower and cook, and it accounts for about 20% of energy usage in homes. We encourage people to think about having an efficient hot water heater, and we're able to do that because we're building new construction. You can also do that if you're replacing your hot water heater because it's old. And there are solar hot water heater options. So if the solar from your house isn't enough to take care of all of the electricity, you can layer in a solar hot water heater as well. Once we get past those two components, we really think about having behavior change. So taking shorter showers, not running hot water when you don't need it, really thinking about things like have a full dishwasher before you run it because of the volume of hot water that's needed for those different components. It's not just reducing the water usage, but also reducing the amount of hot water that you're using.
So I imagine for everyone who might not have an efficient water heating system in their home or apartment, the basic principles apply to conserve that energy as well.
Yes, if energy efficient appliances are not an option, you can do other things to be more efficient with water heating. You can lower the temperature setting on the water heater that you have. This helps reduce the loss of heat that is standing by to be consumed. Many factory settings are actually too high, so it's recommended that water heaters are turned down to 120 degrees Fahrenheit. You can insulate your water heater or even the pipes. Just like insulating your walls or roof, that it's a relatively easy and inexpensive way to improve energy efficiency. You can wash your clothes in cold water when possible. You can also install low flow fixtures on your shower heads and faucets, which minimize the wasted water. You can also just make sure to fix any leaky faucets to conserve heated water.
We definitely don't want water and energy to go to waste. We've discussed cooling and heating homes, heating water, energy efficient appliances. I feel like there's a very obvious use of energy that we haven't discussed yet.
Yes, it's keeping the lights on.
Yes, yes. Well, I guess if we can't see, we can't do much of anything else, can we?
Not in the dark. Lighting and the use of electricity to power devices and appliances is definitely another area that uses a lot of energy. Many of the things that we think about or encourage people to do in homes in Serenbe are the type of light bulbs that you're using. So LED light bulbs substantially lower your power bill. As we talked about earlier, having window placement that allow you to just not have lights on. There are so many home designs when you think about floor plans and how your houses are laid out, that window placement is key and critical, depending on what rooms you use at what times of the day to allow natural light in through the windows so you're not having to turn the lights on. If you're in a room and you're not using the room, turn the lights off. If you're leaving your house, have all the lights off in your house before you walk out of the door. How many people leave their home with all of the lights on? If you have a lighting system that's tied to your phone and you can turn the lights off so that if you forgot to do it when you're running out of the house. Anyone can take steps to conserve lighting and energy usage, whether you live in a single family home like this one or an apartment building. A great way to start is by replacing old light bulbs with LED energy efficient bulbs. They are available in almost any store and use 90% less energy while lasting up to 25 times longer than an incandescent light bulb. During the day, use natural light wherever possible. At night, look around your home. If you see appliance lights that are red, blue, or white, determine whether they need to be on or can be turned off to reduce energy usage. There are also power strips with an on and off switch so that you can plug appliances into and simply turn it off when you leave the house.
Whether I lived here in the sustainability dream home or in my own apartment, I could definitely see myself practicing all these tips. How can I determine my own energy usage at home?
It's fairly simple to perform an audit of your energy use at home by paying attention to what you use, how long you use it, and whether there is any way to be more efficient with that process. You can begin to chip away at the amount of energy you access every day. There are great examples online of what to look for, as well as solutions that can meet people wherever they are economically. What started for us as a family dream has evolved into this amazing community. And I really believe it all began with us wanting to live sustainably and to protect the forest in our own backyard.
I agree. Thank you so much for inviting us into your community, Garnie.
Oh, thank you for visiting Serenbe today.
Now that you have a better understanding of the benefits of using renewable resources and ways to conserve energy, in what ways do you think you can become more energy efficient? Whether it's changing a light bulb or exploring renewable energy, any steps we take will protect the natural resources Earth provides. It's a great way to ensure that we can keep the lights on. I'm Raiany Silva, and thanks for watching. For more, visit gpb.org/letsgoenviro.